Welcome to lesson 6 of my filmmaking terms and analysis unit. This lesson will be talking about the camera's eye, the camera lens. I want you to try something. I want you to hold your hand in front of your face, but hold it close, and I want you to concentrate on the palm of your hand. What happens to the background when you're focusing on the palm of your hand? What about if you then shift your focus to the background? Do you notice what happens? If you just focus on the palm of your hand, the background goes out of focus. And if you focus on the background, your hand goes out of focus. Just like your camera has a lens, your eye has a lens. So the technology in a camera isn't that different from your eyeball. When you gaze at the center of your hand, the background goes out of focus, creating shallow focus. We're going to talk about what shallow focus is, what lenses are similar to the human eye, and what lenses are different, how to create shallow focus, and how to create deep focus, and how to change focus on a lens. All of that and more in today's lesson on camera lenses. So if you have your film terms for cinematography, the section for camera lenses is section E. Our first term for camera lenses is focal length. Focal length is a number expressed in millimeters, so it's a type of measurement. It indicates the lens's angle of view. You can kind of figure out your own angle of view just by taking your hands and spreading them out until you can't see them anymore. So that's your angle of view. The angle of view is how much of the scene will be captured. As you can see in both of these examples, when you change your lens and change your angle of view, you can capture more of a surrounding with a wider angle of view, and obviously the opposite. You can capture less of a surrounding with a narrower angle of view. In the example of the man, the lenses are changing, and the position of the tripod is also changing. So we're seeing a medium close-up from a bunch of different lenses, but the tripod itself is moving. The differences that we see in the background and the man's face are not just created by the lens. They're primarily created by distance. With certain lenses, you can get a close-up shot from a close distance, and with other lenses, you have to stand further back in order to get a close-up shot. Otherwise, you would be creating an extreme close-up. With wider angle lenses, to get a close-up, you have to get really close to your subject because it's hard to not capture a lot of the surroundings. But with longer lenses, you can stand further back to get your close-up, and you'd have to go really far away to create an extreme long shot. The angle of view in the graphic with the yellow angle, it is creating a long shot of the trees. So that specific lens being demonstrated could capture the full tree from that distance. It's all about what distance you are at and what lens you're using at that distance. That combination is going to create the shot size, and it's also going to determine a number of other factors, including depth of field, which we will cover shortly. A wide-angle lens is any lens that captures an angle of view wider than a 35mm lens. But just because it's wider doesn't mean the number goes up. It's actually the opposite. It's any lens with a measurement smaller than 35mm. So when the millimeter measurement goes down, the angle of view widens. Wide-angle lenses have a wide angle of view. Their images appear to expand space. With a wide-angle lens, a medium close-up of this man requires you to get very close. We can't even see the gazebo behind him, but it does appear like the trees behind him are very far away. You'll notice with other lenses that we'll look at, the trees will appear much closer, and we'll be able to see the gazebo behind him, because to capture a medium close-up, we would have to be very far away from him. But with a wide-angle lens, a medium close-up is going to be very close to your subject. Again, these lenses appear to expand space because of this requirement to get close to your subject, and therefore everything else seems far away. The depth between near and far objects appears to be greater when shooting with a wide-angle lens. Most phone cameras use a wide-angle lens, something between a 24 and a 28 millimeter measurement for the lens. So you're going to have to be very close to your subject if all you have is a wide angle lens in order to capture a close-up or a medium close-up. Next, we're going to look at normal lenses, but before I move on, the lens that I have mounted to my camera right now is a normal lens. It sees at about the same angle of view as the human eye. But what if I switch that lens to a wide angle lens? Then what will we see if we don't move the camera? This lens is equivalent to 16 millimeters. We just switched from a 50 millimeter lens, which we'll talk about in a second, is normal, to a 16 millimeter lens. Just for reference, the camera is about 6 feet away from me, and you're capturing all of this part of my apartment, which, by the way, is not pleasant to see. So we're going to switch back to a normal lens. Ah, that's better. So this is a 50 millimeter lens equivalent on my camera, and we'll talk a little bit about the difference between full frame and different types of camera sensors, but it's not super important that you know that right now. All you need to know right now is that the lens that typically comes with a smartphone is a wide angle lens. It's not a 16 millimeter equivalent, but it's somewhere between a 24 and a 28 millimeter equivalent. You may have heard of phones using different types of lenses, and we can get to that in a second. But with that wide angle that I just showed you, you'd have to get really close to me to get this type of shot. And because you have to get so close, the background would look like it was much further away from me. See, if you back away from someone, the image starts to flatten out. You see less depth, but if you're really close to them, things behind them seem really far away. And it's just a matter of perspective. So it's not all about the lens, but it's the combination between lens choice and how far the camera is from the subject. Next up, we have the normal lens. Now remember, different lenses have different angles of view. That's why a wide angle lens requires you to get very close to fill the frame with your subject, because that angle is so wide that it wants to capture everything around your subject more than just one subject. The normal lens is kind of a happy medium. Normal lenses have a focal length between 35 millimeters and 50 millimeters. So a 35 millimeter lens is right on the edge of being a wide angle lens, and a 50 millimeter lens like this one here is right on the edge of the next category we'll get to. 50 millimeter lenses for quite a while were considered the most normal lens because of their 45 degree angle of view. It was considered closest to the human eye. It is close to 45 degrees, so a 50 millimeter lens is a good choice if you want a normal perspective based on the position of the camera. This is why the 50 millimeter lens is referred to as the nifty 50, because it's really close to the way a human eye would see from the same distance. Again, normal focal lengths are from 35 millimeters to 50 millimeters. But let's get back to the 50 millimeter lens. Yasuhiro Ozu, one of Japan's most influential directors, mainly shot with a 50 millimeter lens. See from both of these shots that it gives a very natural perspective. Yasuhiro Ozu was able to place the camera in the room basically about the same distance that a human would be in order to see the same image. These images are very natural and believable images if you were there with the people in his films. However, as it turns out, 50 millimeter lens is not the most normal. It's not the closest you can get to the human eye. Remember, I mentioned that the 50 millimeter lens creates a 45 degree angle of view, but the human eye sees in a slightly wider angle of view than 45 degrees. We actually see in a very wide angle of view, but our brain is only able to perceive about 55 degrees. So the human eye essentially has a 55 degree angle of view, which happens to be the exact same angle of view as a 43 millimeter lens. It seems like an odd number to label a lens, so you don't see a lot of 43 millimeter lenses. But if you have a lens that can change focal length, like the ones we'll talk about shortly, or Or if you can find a 43 or something equivalent to a 43 millimeter lens, you would be creating the most natural, normal look. The image you see here was shot with a 43 millimeter focal length, so the angle of view, or the field of view as it is sometimes referred to, is 55 degrees. Here you can see the range of normal lenses from the 35 to the 50 millimeter. This is a great illustration from bhphoto.com of the differences between the two ranges of normal lenses. You can see how the slight differences in angle of view would create a slightly different image depending on which lens is chosen if you were to keep the camera in the exact same spot. So we've spoken about the wide-angle lens and the normal lens, like the lens that you are looking at me with, the 50 millimeter focal length. Next, we're going to talk about the telephoto lens. So beyond 50 millimeters, we're getting in really close. If I switch this to a telephoto lens, in order for me to maintain a similar shot, a similar frame, if I switch to a telephoto lens, I will have to move my tripod further away. Any lens with a focal length above 50 millimeters has a more narrow field of view than normal human vision. Now what we're looking at is telephoto. This is a 100 millimeter equivalent focal length. So the angle of view is much narrower. As you can see, I don't have much room to move around before I get cut out of the frame. So even though the camera is in the exact same position as it was before, this shot is not so great, and in order to achieve a similar shot that I achieved at a 50 millimeter equivalent, I would have to move the camera further back away from me. But you may notice something about how blurry the background is and how I'm basically the only thing in focus, and it's still kind of hard to stay in focus. I kind of have to stay in one spot. And we'll talk about that when we talk about focus, because a telephoto lens is better for achieving this kind of look. I could even move the camera back further and still get that look of the blurry background and me barely in focus. So again, a telephoto lens narrows the field of view, bringing that frame in around me tightly from the same position as a normal lens, or especially a wide angle lens. So this field of view is far more narrow than a human eye. Let's switch back to something more regular. Because of the narrow field of view, or the narrow angle of view that these lenses have, objects appear to be closer together. These lenses appear to compress space, but it's not just because of the lens choice. It's primarily because in order to get the good shot, you'll have to move further away, but this can be beneficial. If you're creating a fight scene, for example, a telephoto lens will help you create the illusion that two fighters are very close together. It will help to sell fake swings and hits and punches because they'll appear to make contact with each other. And once you add the sound effect of a punch, the audience will be convinced that the two objects collided. A telephoto lens can create that illusion even if your actors are swinging 3 feet away from each other, not even coming close to making contact. That's how much a telephoto lens can create that illusion that space is being compressed. And the reason is because both objects are far away from the camera and therefore appear to be flattened. When you stand far away from two subjects, the distance between those two subjects is much smaller than the distance between you and both of those subjects, so they appear to be closer together. Again, it has less to do with the lens and more to do with the distance combined with the lens's angle of view. Here you can see, starting closer to a normal lens with a 70 millimeter, the man and the gazebo are both visible because we are far enough away to capture both of them. We're not right up in his face with him blocking the gazebo. And then as the millimeter count goes up, as we go further and further into telephoto and super telephoto, you can see that the distance between the man and the gazebo appears to compress. You can go to the 500 millimeter example and see how close he appears to be to that gazebo that we once couldn't even see because of how close we were with that wide angle lens. Again, these lenses appear to compress space not just because of the lens choice, but because of the distance that that lens choice forces you as a camera operator to operate from. But knowing that, you can construct shots that have a different appearance of depth. You may notice something else that changes from shot to shot. You may notice that the last image has a much shallower depth of field. And even though you don't know that term yet, you can see it yourself. The man is in focus, but the background is out of focus. Kind of like when you hold your hand in front of your face and concentrate on it. Some phones, like the iPhone SE and the Galaxy S10, include an additional lens that is marketed as a telephoto lens. Both the iPhone SE and the Galaxy S10 offer a lens with a focal length equivalent to a 52 millimeter lens. So it's just slightly above 50 millimeters, just a tiny bit above a normal lens range. So yes, technically it is a telephoto lens, but only barely. I guess they didn't want to call it a normal lens. That doesn't sound as exciting. However, when compared to the wide-angle 24 to 28 millimeter equivalent lens, the telephoto lens option on a smartphone can achieve much different types of shots, as you can see in these examples. So it does give you more variety and options, and again, it allows you to change some small details like that detail holding your hand in front of your face that we mentioned before, and I promise we'll talk about depth of field very soon. But before we do that, let's talk a little bit about the difference between full frame and different types of camera sensors. The term full frame comes from the standard film frame. So when cameras ran film strips through and exposed celluloid to light, the film strips had a square shape to them, and the shape of that strip is what we call full frame. The measurement of its width and its height is the full frame, and everything else is compared to it. We still measure lenses based on that full frame, and when you change the size of the frame inside of the camera's sensor, you affect the focal length. Full-frame digital camera sensors can be expensive. More affordable digital cameras come with smaller sensors. So if you use the same lens on a full-frame camera, it's going to have a different effect than if you use it on a camera with a smaller sensor. Some more affordable camera sensors include the APS-C camera sensor and the MFT camera sensor. MFT stands for Micro Four Thirds. For example, the affordable yet effective DSLRs that I use in my classroom are the Canon SL2 DSLRs, which have an APS-C sensor. The size of that sensor creates what we call a crop factor. The image coming in through a full frame lens is cropped inside of the camera when that light hits a smaller sensor. Makes sense, right? If an image is coming through the lens and you have a smaller area to capture it, you're only going to capture a piece of that image, almost like you're cropping in on a full image. But this doesn't mean that you can't capture a 50 millimeter image. It just means that you can't use a 50 millimeter lens to capture it, because the measurement of the lens is usually measured by what it would appear to be on a full frame camera. So the equivalent is often listed in the small details on Amazon or bhphoto.com, and learning about lenses before you purchase them is a good idea. You would want to know that when you buy your 50 millimeter, it's going to look like a 50 millimeter. Or maybe you should buy a different lens to get that 50 millimeter nifty 50 look. For a Canon SL2, you would want to use a lens between 27 millimeters and 31 millimeters to get that normal look. Remember, 43 millimeters is the most normal. To get a 43 millimeter equivalent, you would have to use a 27 millimeter lens on an APS-C sensor. So remember, when you have a smaller sensor, you're cropping into the image. So a wider lens would look more telephoto with a smaller sensor. The APS-C has a 1.6 times crop factor, which means you would do a simple multiplication. Take the millimeter measurement of the lens and multiply it by 1.6, and you'll get the equivalent focal length. So if you want that 43 millimeter normal look, you would use a 27 millimeter lens. You can see the math here. If you want something closer to 50 millimeters, you would use a 30 millimeter lens on a Canon SL2. The camera that you're seeing me with has a Micro Four Thirds sensor. It's not the Panasonic GH5, but if you have that camera, it's also using a Micro Four Thirds sensor, an MFT sensor. An MFT sensor has a 2x crop factor, even smaller than the APS-C, but you can still achieve a 50mm look if you have a 25mm lens, which is what you're seeing me with. So 25 times 2 is the 50mm look, the nifty 50. If I wanted to get even closer to a normal angle of view, a normal focal length similar to the angle of view that a human eye can achieve, I would need to switch to a 21.5mm lens, and I don't have one, so this 25mm lens is as close as I can get. I could also invest in a lens that can change focal length, which we're about to talk about. That is the zoom lens. So we've talked about wide angle, normal lenses, telephoto lenses, focal length in general, which applies to all lens measurements, angle of view, which is resulting from the various focal lengths, different angles of view, and now we have something you've probably heard, the zoom lens. And when we think of a zoom lens, we don't realize, perhaps, that it's changing the angle of view. We know we feel like we're getting closer when we zoom in, but what's actually changing is the angle of view is changing from wider to narrower. So you feel like you're getting up close, but you're just shrinking your field of view. You're shrinking the angle of view, and it magnifies the image. It makes it feel closer to you. Any lens that can change its focal length is referred to as a zoom lens. When you buy a zoom lens, both the minimum focal length and the maximum focal length will be labeled on the lens, and often increments in between those focal length ranges will be marked on the lens so that you can, for example, achieve 18 millimeters, 24 millimeters, 35 millimeters, and 55 millimeters on a standard lens that might come with your camera, like the kit lens that we see in the middle. Kit lenses are great for learning about different focal lengths, but there are reasons you would choose to invest in more expensive prime lenses, lenses that focus on a single focal length. So it's not always the case that you would want a zoom lens. You might think to yourself, why wouldn't you want a zoom lens? It has a range of focal lengths to choose from. But with everything that has a benefit, there's also a downside. A zoom lens tends to have a smaller aperture. That's the opening inside of the lens. That's what lets light in. So with the smaller aperture, you get less light. So you would have to add more light to the scene, or you would have to compromise your image by increasing the brightness of your camera, which will add noise and decrease the quality of the image. So with all things, it's a balance of choosing what you need. If you want to start with a zoom lens and practice different focal lengths, that's great. If you want to start with a nifty 50 and move closer and further away from your subject with a prime lens that has a wide aperture, that's also great. With zoom lenses, there's also the option to actively change your focal length during the shot. You can zoom in and zoom out in the middle of a shot. People new to filmmaking and film analysis have a problem telling the difference between a zoom in and a push in, a pull away and a zoom out. Here we have two examples. One example uses a dolly to move forward, pushing into the subject, and one example uses a zoom lens to narrow the focal length, making the subject magnify as the lens is zoomed in. Can you tell the difference between these two examples? Can you tell the difference between a push in and a zoom in? If you can't, then you need to avoid using the term zoom, or you'll just keep referring to every camera movement that moves forward as a zoom. You can tell the difference by focusing on more than just the subject. If you look at the surroundings of the subject, what's behind the subject, for example, you'll see that different objects at different distances are moving at different speeds in one of the examples. In the other example, the objects close and far away are moving at the same speed. That's because the angle of view is just narrowing. The subject is not getting closer to the camera. The lens is magnifying the image. Now that I've gone through that spiel, hopefully you can tell the difference between a dolly shot and a zoom shot. Hopefully you can tell the difference between a push in and a zoom in. Hopefully you can tell the difference between a pull away and a zoom out. Remember, when the camera is zooming in or out, the objects are not really moving. We're just magnifying the image by narrowing the focal length, or demagnifying the image by widening the focal length. So which is it? Which example do you think is the dolly shot, and which example do you think is the zoom? Hopefully you can tell that the example on the left is the dolly shot. You can tell by focusing on the background and the foreground. The woman is moving at a different speed than the men behind her because they are at different distances. That's the effect of moving into a space. The camera is literally getting closer. With the zoom, we're not getting closer. We're just magnifying the image. We're just taking what would be seen and making it bigger than the frame. Zoom lenses can zoom, but when you combine them with a dolly shot, you get the dolly zoom. The dolly zoom is achieved by zooming in while pulling away on a dolly, or zooming out while pushing in with a dolly. You're either widening your angle of view while getting closer, or you're narrowing your angle of view while pulling further away. You zoom a lens to adjust the focal length while the camera dollies in an opposite direction, toward or away from the subject. This is also known as the Hitchcock zoom, the vertigo effect, and the Zolly. Hitchcock directed the film Vertigo, so those first two alternative titles for this effect were originally established because he was one of, if not the first director, to really impress an audience with this effect. You can see the vertigo shot in the upper left example. So Hitchcock's dolly zoom actually moves the camera downward while zooming out, still going opposite directions, but probably very difficult to achieve. You can see three other examples of the dolly zoom here, one from the French film La Haine, one from Lord of the Rings, and one from Goodfellas. As you can see, this is a very peculiar type of shot that will probably make your audience feel uneasy, or they might not even notice it until halfway through the effect, and they have no idea what's going on. The average film viewer or television viewer has no idea what's happening when they see a dolly zoom, and that's kind of why it's so awesome, because it looks nothing like anything we normally experience as a human viewer in everyday life. It's bizarre. The background is growing while we don't see the subject size change at all. The people in the diner in the Goodfellas shot stay generally the same size while the background seems to grow around them, and that's just because our distance is changing. From different distances and different angles of view, things look different in size. So when you're actively changing those things in opposite ways, distance and focal length, you get this really cool effect, the dolly zoom. Next up, we have focus. And most people are familiar with the term focus. It's how sharp or blurry the image is, or the specific subject in an image is. So we can use the general terms sharp and blurry, but we can get even more descriptive in how we analyze an image based on the focus of the lens. To get more descriptive and analytical, I have to introduce the term depth of field. Depth of field is the distance between the nearest sharp part of the image and the furthest sharp part of the image. It refers to the depth of focus, the distance between near and far objects when they are both in focus. When we talk about depth of field, it's not a precise science. It's what you see in an image. If you look at an image and you see only one object in sharp focus, that's one kind of depth of field. It's a very small depth of field, and we have a term for that. If you see an image and many different objects from different distances, close and far, are in acceptable focus, that's a different kind of depth of field. It's a larger depth of field, and we have a term for that. But first, let's focus on the smaller depth of field, shallow focus. Shallow focus is when your depth of field is small. A small area of the scene is in focus while the rest of the scene is out of focus. This can be achieved in a number of ways, and you could even combine all of these ways. It's achieved with an aperture, and I mentioned this before. It's the opening that lets light into the lens. Your eye has an aperture. Have you ever seen someone's pupil get wide in a dark room and small in a very bright room? That is your eye's aperture changing sizes. You let less light in, so your pupil gets small, or you let more light in if it's dark and your pupil gets big. And you can test this out. You can turn on and off the lights in a room and watch your friend's pupil change sizes. It's adjusting to let more or less light in. Again, hold your hand in front of your face and squint your eyes very close, using your eyelids as an aperture to let less light in. You'll notice that the background gets a little bit sharper. You can see things behind your hand, even though you're still focused on your hand, a little bit better when you squint your eyes nearly to the point where they're shut. This is why you naturally squint your eyes to see things that are far away, because you are naturally adjusting your focus with your eyelid. The less light you let into the lens of the camera, the sharper the image will be, and the more light that you let into the lens of the camera, the shallower the depth of field. You can achieve a shallow focus more easily when you let more light into the lens. You can also increase the focal length. You can change your lens choice, or you can zoom in on a zoom lens to a higher focal length. A higher focal length actually makes it easier to achieve shallow depth of field. So by switching to a telephoto lens and opening the aperture as wide as possible, you can achieve a very shallow depth of field. You can also place your camera closer to the subject. So if all you have is the wide-angle lens on your phone, that is the easiest way to achieve a shallow depth of field. Get as close to your subject as possible and focus on that one subject while leaving space for the background, filling the image with things that are far away. Your lens of your camera on your phone will focus on that object that's close, and the things in the frame that are distant will appear to be out of focus. Again, there are three primary ways to change your depth of field. That would be adjusting the opening of the lens, the aperture, changing lenses from a wide angle to a telephoto lens makes it easier to achieve a shallow depth of field, or vice versa. And the closer a camera is to a subject, the easier it is to achieve a shallow depth of field, or shallow focus. Next up, we have the term rack focus. Rack focus is when you use shallow depth of field and adjust the focus of the lens in the shot. So during the shot, you are actively changing where the lens is focused based on distance. It's best achieved with a shallow focus because it's more noticeable. It's more noticeable when you change what's in focus when you're in shallow focus because such a great deal of the image is out of focus and such a small portion of the image is in focus, you can really see it move from close to far or far to close or from one subject that's near to another subject that's far. Again, if the focus is shallow, this effect is more noticeable. But if you're watching a television show or movie tonight, I want you to pay attention to whose face is in focus. You'll probably find that it's the person who's speaking. You're usually tricked into focusing on the speaker because of this technique. It's actually someone's job on set to change focus. It's not the camera operator. It's a separate person whose sole responsibility and the reason they're getting paid is to make sure that the right subject is in focus at the right time. They're called a focus puller, and nowadays they do it remotely. They're not even touching the camera. They're holding a remote control, looking at a screen, and nailing the focus on the right subject at the right time. Again, it's usually the person who's speaking. So if you want to really notice that this is happening, focus on the person who's not speaking when you're watching a movie or television show. You'll notice that they're probably out of focus. Now that we've spoken about shallow focus and how you can use it to achieve a rack focus effect, let's switch to the opposite of shallow focus, shall we? It's the deep focus. Deep focus is when a large area of the scene is in focus. Things that appear close and things that appear far away are in an acceptable level of focus. This is achieved by making the aperture smaller, that opening in the lens. Remember, when you squint, you can see more in focus, even though your eyelashes are getting in the way and the image is getting darker. More of the image is sharp when less light is coming into the lens. So when you decrease the size of the lens's aperture, that little opening that lets light in, you can create a deeper focus. It can also be achieved by decreasing the size of the focal length. You'll notice that these two shots appear to be shot on wider angle lenses. So a wide angle lens is going to have more of the image in focus and make it more difficult to achieve shallow focus. Remember, I said the best way to achieve shallow focus on your smartphone with that 24 to 28 millimeter lens, the wide lens on your smartphone, is to get close to the subject. So again, we can't change the focal length unless you have a telephoto lens option on your phone. The most effective way of achieving deep focus on your cell phone is the opposite of getting close. It's to get further away from your subject, and most shots that you capture with a smartphone will be in deep focus because you don't normally get super close to a subject when you're taking an image with the wide-angle lens on your smartphone. But when you're doing your practice, which I'm about to introduce, you should use distance to create shallow and deep focus examples using your smartphone if you don't have a telephoto lens option on your smartphone. You're going to have to get very close to your subject to achieve shallow focus and leave part of the frame open for the background so we can see that it's out of focus, and you're going to have to step away from that subject to get your deep focus example, which again is a much easier thing to do on a wide angle lens. As you can see in both of these examples, the things in the background behind the main character are in focus. The field behind Leonardo DiCaprio in Revenant is in focus. The subway train car behind Captain Marvel and all of the people in it are in focus. This is the opposite of shallow focus. Both of these are great examples of deep focus. So here is your challenge. I want you, with your device, probably a smartphone, to try to achieve a shallow focus shot. Again, you're probably going to have to get close to your subject. Get extremely close to a subject and focus on it, but leave enough of the background in the image so that we can tell that the background is out of focus. Make sure your phone's camera is focusing on the extremely close subject, just like I told you to concentrate on your hand when it was close to your face. For your deep focus shot, I want you to move a little bit further away from that same subject, but make sure that there's still plenty of space between your subject and the background so that we can see that things that are close and far away are both in acceptable focus. So don't go really far away from that close-up subject, just move 4 or 5 steps back, and with your wide-angle lens on your phone, that's really all you'll need to prove that the wide-angle lens is great at achieving deep focus shots. As you know, most of the time when you take images with your phone, they're in acceptably sharp focus throughout the image. Not just things that are close, but things that are far away as well. Make sure when you take these two examples that the shallow focus shot has only one subject in acceptably sharp focus, and for your deep focus shot, make sure that everything in the frame, for the most part, is in acceptably sharp focus. Lastly, I want you to attempt an example of rack focus. This isn't so easy on a smartphone, but it is possible. I want you to get extremely close to a subject, like in the shallow focus practice, but I want you to change focus, to shift focus from that extremely close subject to something extremely far away. You can do this because every smartphone has the ability to touch different things to focus on them. Instead of just pressing on two different things, I want you to create a shot that has a lot of depth. Things that are close, things that are in the mid-ground, and things that are in the background. Lots of different objects going further and further away from you. This is an acceptable way to practice rack focus and at least give it a shot. I know it's not as ideal as having a focus ring on a fancy camera to adjust focus, but it is a cool way where you can give the rack focus a shot. Alternatively, if you have manual control over the focus of your smartphone, you can do this more effectively without using the touch focus feature. If you have manual control, your camera app may have a dial for focus that you can unlock if you find the right settings. For example, I have a Samsung Galaxy S8 phone. It's not the newest in the line of Samsung Galaxy smartphones, but it does have manual settings. As you can see, I'm able to dial in and out, moving my focus closer and further away from my subject. So even though I'm on that wider 24 to 28 millimeter equivalent lens, I'm still able to rack focus between things that are extremely close to my phone and things that are extremely far away. You can see from these examples that the manual settings on your phone can unlock features you may have not known existed. So do a little bit of research on the internet to see if your smartphone has a way of achieving manual focus instead of autofocus. Can you change the focus manually instead of letting the camera automatically change focus? And if not, you can use the touch focus box and focus from close objects to far away objects. And if your camera's autofocus is freaking out, try to do it a few times until your autofocus cooperates and creates a pleasing rack focus from something very close to something very far away while you're recording a video. So that's three examples. I want one shallow focus example, one deep focus example, and one rack focus example. The first two can be still images, and the last one should be a video clip. Try to trim off the beginning and end of the clip until I'm only seeing the rack focus example that you want me to see. And since sound is not relevant to this exercise, you can mute the video. If you're not one of my students, I still recommend that you try this exercise. Even with a smartphone, it can be a good way to learn more about the options that you have when it comes to depth of field. And now you know more about the lens on your smartphone and why shooting on a smartphone has its limitations, especially when it comes to your choice of lenses, your choice of focal length, and your choice of depth of field. We mentioned zoom lenses before, and it's important to note that the zoom on your phone is digital. So when you swipe out to zoom in, you're not just magnifying the image, you're also decreasing the quality of the image. The image that's being magnified is not through magnification of light, but through magnification of pixels. So you will create a more pixelated, grainy, lower quality image by widening your fingers to zoom in. So it's never recommended that you use a digital zoom on any project in my class. Well, that's all for camera lenses. Hopefully you learned something about focal length and depth of field. Goodbye for now, and I'll see you next lesson.